Hi, Serdar Yegulop here with InfoWorld at IDG. In this episode of Smart Python, I'll be giving a brief overview of the SQLite 3 database that's included with Python, a fast and easy way to store structured data outside of an application and reuse it. SQLite 3 is a tiny but powerful database system delivered as a single binary. Python has habitually included SQLite 3 for many versions now, so it's a convenient and powerful way to build applications that need some kind of persistent data store. SQLite 3 itself is one of the most widely deployed databases in the world. There's a good chance the device you're watching this video on uses it in some way. It's also one of the most dependable and consistent such products. It's not a toy project. SQLite, as the name implies, uses the SQL standard for how data is stored and retrieved. I won't go into a lot of detail about how the standard works. I've put a link below to where you can read more about this. But the basic idea is that you issue commands to the database in the form of strings, and you get back results that you can then iterate through and perform operations on. Now, one nice thing about SQLite, especially in Python, is that apart from the SQL syntax, there is very little setup involved for an application. Other database products like MySQL require you to install the product and go through a setup process for each database. For SQLite, the setup is just a few lines of Python code. The first thing we need to do is create our database and connect to it, and so I have written a function here that does exactly that. It connects to a database file in our project with the name database.db, or if no such file exists, it will create it and prepare it for use. The database connection is an object, and with it we create another object that we use to send commands and receive data. This object is called a cursor, and this function here makes the connection and the cursor, and then returns both of them for use elsewhere. Now, I've made this into its own file because we're going to reuse these commands a couple of times throughout this demo, so it makes sense to break these things out on their own. Now, here we have some code to create the structures in the database that hold data, also known as the tables. Again, if you're not familiar with database parlance, the linked article on SQL can help. By the way, this code up top here, this just erases any existing database file beforehand. It's just something I whipped up as part of this demo. You won't normally do this. After we make our connection to the database and get back our connection and cursor objects, we then pass in a command that creates an empty table named users with two text columns, name and email. The execute method for the cursor object sends the database the command we have here to create the table with those parameters. The commit method ensures the results of that command are finalized in the database. We need to commit operations so that we can do things like group a bunch of operations together under one commit for the sake of efficiency, or so that we can checkpoint a complex operation at different stages along the way. The next thing we want to do is insert some data. This we do as a separate command to execute. But note here how we have formatted this command. We have two variables, username and user email, that we want to pass along as part of our insert operation. But we don't include them in line. SQLite uses a special syntax where we use a question mark in the statement to indicate a placeholder for a variable. And then we pass the variables themselves separately as a tuple. This way the cursor object can figure out how best to format those variables for the sake of consistency and security. If we're going to run a whole bunch of similar operations, we can use the execute many method to take a single command and pass it a whole bunch of parameters to execute it with in turn. In this case, we have a users list, each item with a name and an email, and we pass that along to execute many. And then finally, when that's done, we commit everything and we close our database connection. Now, to get data out of the database, we use the cursor to pass in a select command, which selects, as the name implies, rows from the database, and then returns an object containing this information that we can iterate over. The first of these commands just selects all of the columns from the user's table, and then displays the results row by row. The second of these extracts the name and email as named variables, and also uses a different kind of query. It's looking specifically for users with my name, Serdar. Changing data in the database follows a similar pattern. We'll pass in a command to update data, and again we use placeholders for parts of the query where we want to pass in parameters. In this case, I'm changing my name in the database to use my full name, not just my first name. And when we do this, you'll notice this has an effect on the data that we retrieve. The query that we ran before that looked for my name doesn't return anything anymore because it was looking for a precise match on my first name only. The key thing to keep in mind with all this is how the data that we've inserted has persisted across multiple runs of these programs. It's stored outside of our program so we can retrieve it and use it at any time, and it's stored in a highly organized way that is fast to access and modify. It's much harder to do that than by, say, for instance, writing everything out to a text file and then reading it back in every time I start our program. That's okay for just a couple of basic settings, but when you have a lot of structured data, it quickly becomes very unwieldy and becomes very difficult to keep it updated if you're making changes. Finally, the demo that I've just provided here involves working with a database directly. With more complex applications, you typically want to use a framework called an ORM, or Object Relations Mapper. This is a piece of software that lets you abstract your database handling so that you don't have to manually construct these select and insert queries to execute. That is worth exploring in a separate video, though, since there are a number of ORMs available for Python that are widely used. That's it for this video. If you liked it, please leave a comment below. Don't forget to subscribe to the IDG Tech Talk channel on YouTube. And for more Python tips, be sure to follow us on Facebook, YouTube, and InfoWorld.com.